2016 Daniel Burnham Forum on Big Ideas and the beginning of APA's annual Policy and Advocacy Conference. I'm Carol Ray, President of the American Planning Association. APA is pleased to bring you tonight's conversation in partnership with the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development. Thank you all so much for being here tonight, and a special welcome to those who are joining via the webcast. It's my pleasure to once again moderate this important forum. At least at last year's Burnham Forum, we heard from a distinguished panel about ideas and options for communities to pursue approaches to economic growth that are inclusive and equitable. We grappled that night with how we can grow in ways that are inclusive and how we can pursue economic growth, social justice, and social mobility at the same time. This conversation helps spur new work and advocacy at APA, focused on innovative planning policies and processes that can be a tool to help cities address today's serious challenges of equitable growth and access to opportunity. We believe firmly that how we choose to grow and how we engage the public in decisions about that growth are essential to tackling a range of challenges associated with equitable, inclusive growth. One of the most important manifestations of our commitment to this issue has been our work as a partner with HUD in the development of the Prosperity Playbook. This effort is aimed at collaborating with cities and regions to discuss the challenges of opening up new pathways to economic and social opportunity for all, and identifying the policies and programs that are proven and effective from local experience. We'll hear about strategies for addressing challenges from fair and affordable housing to managing neighborhood change. Tonight, we are honored to hear from three leaders in this critical work. HUD's Principal Deputy Assistant Secretary for Community Planning and Development, Harriet Tregoning, Kansas City Mayor Sly James, and Atlanta Mayor Kasim Reed. Each of our speakers played an instrumental role in the development of the Prosperity Playbook. Although they likely need no introduction to an audience of planners, let me briefly introduce them. In her role at HUD, Harriet is responsible for leading an array of programs essential to planners and communities, including community development block grants and HUD's Resiliency Grant Program. Before joining HUD, she was the planning director here in Washington, D.C., and secretary of planning for the state of Maryland. APA has been honored to have her as a partner and as a member for many years. Mayor James has led Kansas City since 2011. He has focused his administration around themes of education, employment, efficiency, and enforcement. He is a native of Kansas City and enjoyed a very distinguished legal career in the city prior to becoming mayor. He has helped lead major new development in the city, including this year's opening of the new streetcar line. APA was pleased last year to honor Kansas City's Crossroads Arts District as a great place in America. Mayor Reed is serving his second term as mayor of the city of Atlanta. Before becoming mayor, he spent 11 years in the Georgia General Assembly, serving both in the Georgia House and Senate. Like Mayor James, he was also a distinguished attorney. Since becoming mayor, he has been a major leader in building and improving the city's infrastructure and bolstering neighborhoods across the city. He has championed the Atlanta Beltline project that has attracted attention across the country and really brings together issues of transportation, health, and affordable housing. The city's economic performance under his leadership has been a model for other communities. He has also become a leading national voice on a range of issues important to cities and good planning. It's a tremendous honor to welcome all three of you to tonight's forum. To kick things off, each of our speakers will make some introductory remarks. Then I'll ask Harriet to engage the mayors in a conversation about how they are pursuing inclusive growth and expanding access to opportunity in their cities and their regions. We'll involve you in that conversation too. There's another person that I need to acknowledge tonight at the outset. This conversation, this entire endeavor would not have been possible without the leadership of HUD Secretary Castro. His personal commitment to this project and to the issue of expanding opportunity has been amazing and inspiring. He'll be with us tomorrow at lunch, so I hope you'll all join us for those remarks. Before I turn the podium over to our distinguished speakers, I want to acknowledge the important role of our partnership in making Prosperity Playbook happen. The National League of Cities Enterprise Community Partners and the Lincoln Institute of Land Policy have played key roles in this effort. These partnerships will extend beyond the release of the Playbook as a product and help us continue to engage local leaders and officials in pursuing the goals embedded in the Playbook. I want to specifically recognize the National League of Cities. National League of Cities has been a big part of this work and will continue to work with us over the coming year. Tomorrow, NLC Executive Director Clarence Anthony will speak at our plenary panel on social equity research. But tonight, I want to invite NLC's Jess Zimbabwe to come to the podium to offer a few introductory thoughts. Jess has led NLC's work on Prosperity Playbook and has long been a key leader in providing technical assistance to local officials through the Rose Center for Public Leadership, which she runs. Jess?
Good evening, everyone, from the National League of Cities. Really delighted to be here. NLC is the largest association of local governments in the United States. We act as a resource and an advocate for 19,000 cities, towns, and villages around the country. A smaller number of those are, of course, active members. About 2,000 cities regularly send their leading elected officials to participate in NLC's meetings, trainings, conferences, policy committees, and efforts like the Prosperity Playbook. We're really delighted to have Mayor Reed and Mayor James here tonight representing two of our more prominent members. And I'm a planner by background. I've been an APA member and AICP certified for many years, so I'm personally delighted for this partnership with APA. But I also am really professionally delighted because I think it was Harriet who told me some time ago that we, as planners, have the best profession because we get to talk about the future, and not just the future of anything, the future of cities. And what could be more important and more exciting than that? I agree, and I'm really excited that this program and this partnership are going to launch a lot of other fertile ground for our two organizations to work together. But more importantly, I'm really excited that it's starting here and with this topic that we're exploring over the next few days with the Burnham Forum and with the meetings tomorrow and with the Prosperity Playbook after that. There's no more important issue than issues of equity and inequity in our cities. And to see the Secretary at Housing and Urban Development and APA and NLC coming together and looking and tackling those really serious issues is important to us. And we're really happy that you're joining us in that effort. Thank you all for being here.
Thank you, Jess, for those comments and for your partnership. Now, I'd like to invite Harriet Tregoning to get us started. Harriet?
Thank you so much, Carol. I'm really delighted to see all of you in the room, a lot of old friends, hopefully a lot of new friends as well. This is a project, as Carol mentioned, that is not just an initiative that Secretary Castro really started himself, but it's really a passion of his. I think many of you know he's the former mayor of San Antonio, and he's a bit biased about how cool mayors are and what a great job it is to be a mayor, and what are the ways in which he could continue to hang out with mayors. And so, you know, in part, that's why we're here. But it's also in part because he basically has a message for all of us who work for him at HUD. He basically calls HUD the Department of Opportunity. So to keep it kind of first and foremost in our minds that housing is absolutely necessary. Clean, safe, affordable housing is necessary, but our job doesn't end with that. Housing is a platform for all kinds of other things that individuals and households need to achieve success in their life and for their families, including economic mobility. So what Prosperity Playbook is about is working with those mayors and their regional partners who are trying to do those kinds of things, really looking at ways to promote economic mobility and a much broader range of opportunities for the citizens that live in their region. And that means tackling some very, very tough issues. So it wasn't every mayor in the country who was doing that. So we have a small handful, five mayors that we're working with in five regions, but they represent, I think, a really amazing cross-section. And I feel particularly honored that we have two such great mayors with us here this evening. Our partnership is intended to plug into a lot of the existing efforts that communities are undertaking. But another important thing that Secretary Castro sees about HUD is that, yes, we have programs, we have funding, we have laws, rules, regulations, and policies, but what makes us most effective when we are effective is when we meet communities where they are and understand what it is that they're trying to do and help them figure out how they use our resources, our money, our expertise, our ability to help forge partnerships to get them where they're trying to go. And that I think the relationship that we have with the five cities of Prosperity Playbook and the surrounding regions are a great example of that. Our objective is to both learn from those communities that are already engaging and innovating, and then take the lessons that we've learned through our kind of deep engagement with these places and to collaborate with a lot of other communities and kind of bring this approach of meeting communities where they are, across the country, but also to every part of HUD. Prosperity Playbook fully recognizes the value of local leadership and local ideas, as well as the need to create a platform to share those ideas. I can just give you one quick example. How many of you have heard about the Mayor's Challenge to End Veterans Homelessness? Okay. Let's talk about what that means, right? That was an initiative that the First Lady started 2 years ago, September of 2014, to address a problem that most people in America thought was utterly intractable and utterly unsolvable. And through a lot of hard work and a lot of partnership, the mayors demonstrated that they could, in a very short period of time, make extremely dramatic progress in not just reducing veterans' homelessness, but also chronic homelessness overall. And I think that it speaks to a couple of qualities that mayors have. They're incredibly competitive with each other. Don't tell anyone, but they are very, very competitive. I was saying to Mayor James that I saw a throwdown between him and the mayor of Memphis, A.C. Wharton, at the time, over barbecue, and I didn't really want to get in the middle of that. But both very competitive, but also incredibly generous and open-handed. I have yet to meet the mayor who had had a successful initiative that wouldn't send his ideas, his legislation, his staff to another city who wanted to take that idea, and do something really amazing with it. I last saw Mayor Reed actually at COP21, where talk about a place where mayors made a difference. They were kind of swaggering around Paris, I gotta say, pretty much saying everything that the United States needs to do and that the world needs to do to cut greenhouse gas emissions is in the very best interests of cities. It makes cities more competitive. It's buildings, it's transportation. We got this. And it really changed the dialogue, it changed the outcome. So it's not a surprise that we would turn to mayors when it comes to Prosperity Playbook to say, hey, you are the innovators. Innovation is increasingly a brand in cities, as many of you know, and we have with us a couple of mayors who are really at the forefront of that innovation. So at each of the sessions that we've done with Prosperity Playbook, we've taken the leadership and the innovation of the mayors, but also brought stakeholders in from across the region, residents, philanthropy, developers, advocates, because change is hard. We'll talk a little bit about how hard it is for change to happen, and nobody does it alone, but mayors are coalition builders, if anybody is. And in our Prosperity Playbook gathering, they've helped to identify who needs to be at the table to have a real dialogue, because those diverse voices are critical to the success of Prosperity Playbook, but also as a blueprint for how others need to approach these problems. Because if it was easy to make opportunity available to everyone in a region, it would have already been done. There are lots and lots of reasons why it's actually very hard to do. Lots of rules, lots of regulation, lots of practices that need to change, and that we need everybody to be part of that coalition. As a result of the ongoing work in each of the contributing regions, we expect Prosperity Playbook to yield, among other new resources, an online toolkit of curated case studies and best practices that support the objectives of the initiative. That means both from these cities, and we're going to talk about a couple of their innovative practices during our conversation, but also from cities around the country, because like I say, imitation is the sincerest form of flattery, and all the mayors we're working with would love to steal some great ideas from other mayors who are trying to do the same thing. We're going to use the next hour to hear from Mayor James and Mayor Reed about their experiences with Prosperity Playbook, including why they would want to get involved in something like this. They're experiencing developing a plan of action and a facilitated discussion about some of their early wins and early progress and how Prosperity Playbook more broadly contributes to regional collaboration and economic mobility. Collaboration is the foundation of Prosperity Playbook. In addition to the mayors and the diverse stakeholders who've signed on to support it in their region, the initiative is also supported by a team of national partners, as Carol mentioned. The American Planning Association, obviously, Enterprise Community Partners, the Lincoln Institute of Land Policy, and the National League of Cities. And I want to thank our partners, especially APA and NLC, for their participation and for helping to facilitate discussion with our regional partners, for supporting the development of our online toolkit of best practices, and for organizing and planning this Burnham Forum and tomorrow's event with the community of practice. The partnership, comprised of local leadership, federal staff, and nonprofit partners, is the foundation of Prosperity Playbook. And let me just say that again: local leadership, federal staff, nonprofit partners, including in some cases philanthropic partners. That is not the normal recipe for how things happen. So it's actually been a real hallmark of the Obama administration, and I think what we're really trying to make it is just a common practice. But I just wanted to point out that this is not how we've always done things at the federal government. And we've really found that this cross-cutting collaboration is essential for sharing knowledge and building capacity across a wide range of issues, including housing affordability and, as we're going to talk today, economic mobility. Let's move now directly into the panel session focusing on Prosperity Playbook. And I want to thank Mayor James and Mayor Reed for participating in the launch of this initiative and for being here with us today. I'll turn it over to them, and starting maybe with Mayor James.
Well, good evening, and thanks for having me. It's always a pleasure to appear with my friend Mayor Reed from Atlanta, but every time I hear about the Beltline project, I feel like I need to get on a scale and explain myself. Wish he could have named it something else. We all know that development is a complex issue. It's multifaceted. And a new phenomenon for at least me and perhaps Mayor Reed as well, and I know in other parts of the country, is the activism around the use of incentives with development. However, playmaking remains a key thing for us to do, and we have to focus on creating areas of our cities where transportation, housing, and quality education, healthcare, access to jobs, easily accessible for all residents of the city. Often financing is a huge challenge in these endeavors, as are other independent market factors. It's certainly no secret that urban areas continue to face some rather unique development challenges compared to suburban areas, not just in terms of access, but also in terms of cost factors. We have to consider such things as gentrification, bank redlining, public safety, public health, high density population factors. In Kansas City, our challenges are even more unique. I think it's important for me to give you a little picture of where and who and what Kansas City is. Kansas City is a very unique city in this country. It is one of only a couple, frankly, where we sit on a state line, and both sides of the state line are very economically viable. There's competition for business, there's a lot of crossover for business, and it has been an issue for quite some time. The region is about 2.5 million. Kansas City itself is 472,000. We sit on 318 square miles. Our density is about 1,460 per square mile. We can fit 8 San Franciscos into Kansas City. We're divided by a line that runs right down the middle of the city, runs north and south, Troost Avenue. It was a historic area where on the west side of Troost, the more affluent side, covenants were passed some time ago that forbid the sale or occupancy of housing and property to Jews and African Americans. And over a period of decades, long decades, I hope, those covenants, although have declared illegal, the impact and effect, both in terms of its physical layout and where people reside, and the emotional impact persists. It is an historic racial and economic dividing line. A lot of attention has been paid to wiping that line out. Now, Prospect Avenue is a commercial thoroughfare where, unfortunately, too little commerce is actually done. That runs north and south through the urban core about a mile to the east of Troost. I lived, growing up, one block east of Prospect. Yet I remember in 1968, when Martin Luther King was assassinated, and we had a curfew, and I was coming back from a nighttime job at the Kitty Clover Potato Chip Factory. Let me tell you, if you like potato chips, I don't suggest that you work at a potato chip factory cleaning up after the shifts, but we were doing that in order to save money for the homecoming dance and prom. And as we turned the corner off of Prospect and went to the corner of my block in the dark, because all the lights were off, the sky lit up with Clegg lights, and the National Guard forced us out of the car onto the ground with rifles and things of that nature. And that was where the riots in Kansas City was, just to give you an idea of the area that we're talking about. Now, Prospect, like I said, is about 1 mile east of Troost. It lies in the heart of a community that has been and continues to be both racially, economically, socially separated from the more affluent west side of the city. And this corridor makes up about an 8 mile stretch that serves as the second busiest travel corridor in Kansas City, carrying about 6,100 passengers a day along that corridor, mostly by bus. So we have chosen to focus on that Prospect Corridor in more ways than one. The Prospect Corridor is indicative of Kansas City's east side, where racial and low-income residents are concentrated. Development opportunities have proven difficult. Disinvestment has occurred at a much more rapid pace than reinvestment, and we have started to take some actions to turn the corner on that issue. Now, the reason that we've chosen Prospect, one reason I should say, is that we have had some success dealing with Troost. We've implemented a plan over several years that have had some real impacts on trying to blur that line, and we felt like we could now use Troost as an anchor on the west and go to the east and bring Prospect back in and start to spread that redevelopment that we need. Unlike a lot of urban areas, we don't really have an affordable housing availability problem. What we have is a population problem. And like a lot of cities in the past, people previously fled for the suburbs. And it's greatly impacted not just the housing stock, but the population and the tax base in those areas. I can also say that the Prospect Corridor sits in the Kansas City Public School District domain. Kansas City Public Schools has had a long history of desegregation and poor performance. The average tenure of a superintendent in KCPS has been about 3 years. I've been in office 5 years, and I'm on my fourth superintendent. Now, in truth, one was there when I got there, hadn't been there that long, left in history your time, then another and another, and now we're on a new one. And he seems to be an extremely good young man. Unfortunately, the same age as my son, And although I think he has some great ideas and he's moved his family and he's put his children in the school, I keep telling him that his greatness will be achieved if he is here for 5 years or longer. And that is a major, major issue. I will say that our population is slowly growing in the city, but not on the east side. Prospect Corridor has just over 18,000 people in it, and advancing transportation and development on the east side, particularly in that corridor, is critical for a number of reasons. Number one, the declining population. While the city's overall population is growing, Prospect Corridor population decreased by half over the last 3.5 decades. It went from 36,000 to 18,000. We have a low medium income. The corridor's medium income is nearly half of the citywide figure of 24,000 compared to 46,000. There's higher levels of poverty. The percentage of people living in poverty is nearly double, 36% to 19%. There's a high concentration of non-white and or Hispanic origin residents. 96% of the residents in that corridor identify as non-white or Hispanic origin. 1/4 of the households do not own a vehicle. Fewer residents in the corridor attain at least a high school education and diploma. 10% fewer, 78% versus 88%. We have higher unemployment rates. The unemployment along that corridor in the labor force is double what it is citywide. And despite these harsh realities, the Prospect Corridor is an area that's currently seeing a concentration of resources and a renewed effort to create catalytic momentum. We've chosen a number of development strategies to help push this process and project along. The Affirmatively Furthering FUR Housing, AFFH, in the Kansas City region began its collaboration with 9 county areas, and we identify with them and work with them to eliminate and identify impediments to fair housing under the Sustainable Communities Grants. Some of these counties and cities are on the Kansas side, some are on the Missouri side. And our region sees the opportunity under the AFH Assessment of Fair Housing Regional Plan to further collaborate together in order to create richer conversations and more collaborative efforts around strategies and goals and engagements and opportunities with various cities and housing authorities throughout the entire region. And our regional plan is now due on November 4th this year, and we believe it will serve as a model for other areas and communities. CDFI, Missouri HUD staff, and in conjunction with the City of Kansas City, Missouri, and Kansas City, Kansas, have engaged federal partners and stakeholders currently working in this arena to plan a CDFI and Financial Institution Foundation convening session to focus on some of those key challenges in the Prospect Corridor. We're doing this in an attempt to promote and create ideas associated with funding and financing the gaps for residential and associated services and development. The Prospect Max BART line and the City of Kansas City and the KCATA, Kansas City Area Transportation Authority, are coordinating efforts to provide enhanced bus transportation and services along the Prospect Corridor, connect residents to job and educational opportunities and health care and other important regional assets. In fact, the Prospect Corridor was the focus of our proposal for the $50 million DOT Vulcan grant. We were not selected. I happen to want to believe that it was because we had been awarded so many other great things that they decided somebody else had to win something, but that's not exactly how what they said. So I just kind of make it up as I go. But that proposal focused on creating an enhanced transportation area similar to our streetcar area, where we are the smartest or the largest smart and connected city in North America. We would have extended that same technology, that same data collection, that same data output, the features of kiosks at various places. We would have embedded passive electric charging stations at every bus stop and used electric buses. We would have employed autonomous and semi-autonomous vehicles to connect the Prospect Corridor going east and west over into the downtown area and to Troost. But even though we did not receive that grant, as we put our package together for that grant, we employed a number of partners and public-private partnerships and generated a total of $125 million, 50 million of which was the grant. But we are working with our partners on the balance to go ahead and do those things that we can. So we're going to do what we plan to do in the Prospect Corridor. It's just going to take a little longer and be a little harder to come up with the resources. It's a big task. It's a huge task. It is a task worth taking. It is a task where I grew up. And I go home to my to where I grew up. I take my kids there to see the house. I held an anti-gun press conference 2 years ago when our legislature, in its infinite stupidity, was loosening the laws on guns even further, and they've done it again by allowing no permit, no training to become the law of the state for 19-year-olds and older. And today, I was in touch with our police department, who had an Operation 100, which is a SWAT team call out for an armed robber four houses down and on the other side of the street from where I grew up. So this is the area that we're focusing our efforts on, and it is being done for good reason. So I want to thank you for allowing me the opportunity to give you that overview. I'm happy to work with Harriet and my friend Mayor Kasim Reed to respond to any questions you may have. And thanks again for having us.
I tell you, Mayor James is so good, it's so unfair. Get out after him. We're friends. We were actually just together, I think last week, we were in Las Vegas, Nevada, having a conversation about smart cities. I want to thank Harriet and Mayor James, and I want to thank the American Planning Association and the Burnham Forum for allowing me to come and visit with you today. I think one of the reasons that I'm here today is because Atlanta has had a history of implementing inclusive policies well. And so this year was the 50th anniversary of HUD in the United States of America, founded by President Johnson, of course. And when that occasion was celebrated, Secretary Castro, who I served with when he was a mayor of San Antonio, chose one city to come to mark that occasion. He came to the city of Atlanta. The reason that he came to the city of Atlanta was because of the city's success in implementing the HOPE 6 initiative, which really did go into every public housing area in the city of Atlanta, radically change it, completely rebuild it, reconstruct it into what is probably the most dynamic mixed-use housing program in the country today. And I think it's changed so many lives, and it's probably one of the reasons that I was asked to participate. I'm excited about what I think the next phase is going to be, and that is I'm figuring out how to guarantee that cities are inclusive and welcoming places. And so I wouldn't have missed the opportunity to be with you all, because I think that you all are going to have one of the most consequential jobs in the life of America going forward. Because the fact of the matter is, all over the world, wherever you travel, people are coming to cities. When I'm sitting with a mayor of China, whether I'm in Guangzhou or if I'm sitting with the mayor of Shenzhen, the biggest decision that mayor has to make is whether people who are coming from rural areas in China, seeking the prosperity of the city, get to stay or not. Right? So if you are a person who lives in a rural area in China and you want to move to Shenzhen and pursue your dreams and the dreams of your family, you have to prove some skill or talent worthy of remaining in that city. I think that that's an appropriate example because it speaks to the challenge that you all have. And that challenge is the world has spoken and America has spoken. 70% of our current GDP is in our metros, and that number is only going to rise. And more than 70% of our population are in our metros. So the challenge that we have and the reason that Prosperity Playbook is so relevant and important is we have to figure out now that that wealthy, smart, talented people believe that cities are the place to live, how do we make sure that they get to live in cities and the people who stayed and stuck the whole time don't get pushed out as a result? And you all are the ones who are going to be informing elected officials on the best tactical steps to take to avoid the reality that is London, that is Abu Dhabi, that is New York, that is San Francisco, that is Los Angeles, that is increasingly Chicago. And cities like mine with 131 square miles, or cities like Mayor James with more than 300 square miles, we have an opportunity to avoid what I've seen in amazing cities like San Francisco. I was in San Francisco and saw a group of middle-class protesters that looked like us in this room throwing bricks at a bus of tech workers who were being bused in to come and work in the heart of San Francisco. So Mayor Ed Lee is a friend of both of ours, and if you asked him what is his most difficult challenge, his challenge is how do you make sure that folks who are in San Francisco the entire time stay? And we're not even talking about race and class, we're talking about middle class white people. So if anybody wonders why we're all here in this room, it's actually very clear, and what we're doing here is going to be increasingly important to the American fabric. Because we're going to have to be able to say that we have a big enough tent and that we can figure out how to take concrete steps so that you don't fear that prosperity is pushing you out. Because increasingly in my town, when we make major announcements that would draw broad praise, so when we announce that we're going to take Turner Field now that the Atlanta Braves got a $400 million subsidy from the suburbs that I never would have given, and we're going to take that neighborhood that used to be interrupted 81 times a day, and we're going to partner with Georgia State University and Carter, and we're going to take a neighborhood which is one of the most challenged zip codes in the city of Atlanta, and we're going to do a $350 million mixed-use development, and the people who were there are going to stay. Typically, that announcement would bring broad praise. But what I'm saying that it brings is fear from the people who are living there, who when they hear $350 million in new investment, hear me being bought out or forced out because of the rise in property taxes. 10 years ago, there was a graduate student named Ryan Gravel. He was at Georgia Tech, and he noticed that there were 22 miles that circled the city of Atlanta like an emerald necklace that were largely abandoned and contaminated. And this young man had the gumption to find his way to see my predecessor, Mayor Franklin, and say that you should reclaim this railway, and that you should build it out, and that you should use it to connect 45 neighborhoods in the city of Atlanta. Well, because he was tenacious, he actually persuaded Mayor Franklin to take on that project. And last Monday, the New York Times front page discussed the Atlanta Beltline as one of the most transformational transit projects in America and the world. And what we have done in Atlanta is we've taken $450 million in public funds. We have acquired more than 60% of that old rail footprint. It runs through 45 neighborhoods. It will be a series of bike paths, walking paths, trails, and light rail transit that will preserve 1,300 acres of green space in our city. It will lead to more than 48,000 construction jobs and $20 billion in new investment. Today, the $450 million in public funds has leveraged $3.6 billion in private investment. It's also attracted $54 million in private philanthropy. And through the help of the United States Department of Transportation, we won an $18 million Tiger Grant to actually expand it so it runs east through south and west. Because as we started doing it, the same old conversations of race came up, that the Atlanta Beltline was really a high line for rich people and it would never reach black people. And so the project started to fray because the question was, should you be deploying all of these tax dollars to a program that benefits the affluent? Because we have shown that we have the capability to expand it south and west, it has eliminated that conversation. What's the point of my talk in that regard? My point is, y'all, we have to be taking on equity all the time. And it got so intense to the city of Atlanta that I have made a member of my cabinet, I hired a chief equity officer. And what the chief equity officer does is to hold my administration's senior leadership accountable. You all know in the planning phase, we focused on getting things done. If there isn't some force that pushes back against our planning, whether it's transportation, whether it's the Bureau of Buildings, whether it's new acquisitions, someone needs to be making the point, are you looking out for the least of these or people who have been here the whole time? And so the Atlanta Beltline is driving the property tax digest in the city of Atlanta in a more dynamic way than everything else we're doing. And the crazy thing is 10 years in, it was one of those projects where you never know you needed it until you started to feel it and experience it. And so now on the Atlanta Beltline, last year we had 1.4 million users. So to give you some sense of magnitude, we've got the largest aquarium in the world that had about 1.1 million users. We have the World of Coca-Cola that has about a million visitors. The city of Atlanta is among the five most visited cities in the United States of America. Last year, we had 49 million guests. The Martin Luther King Center had more than 1 million visitors. The Atlanta Beltline exceeded all of it. These folks had a lantern parade last week. 25,000 people came out to make lanterns. Who knew? What that says to me is that people have a genuine longing for connectivity and sense of community. And when people ask me what we're getting out of the Atlanta Beltline, when we're done, 45 of our strongest neighborhoods of mixed race, mixed income, mixed geography will be able to walk to one another. That's what you see right now. And so we built a $100 million, 2.8-mile streetcar. Since we built that streetcar, we've attracted $1.5 billion in new investment within the five-minute walk of that streetcar. I'm now expanding the Atlanta streetcar, and I'm going to connect it to the Atlanta Beltline, which is going to add even greater connectivity. And we have made a demand that of the 40,000 units of housing that will come along the Atlanta Beltline, that 5,600 of them be affordable. We also passed a law in Atlanta that says that when you use public financing, any of the city's public tools, we of course have the right to demand 15 to 20% of inclusive housing. It's not as strong as inclusionary policies in New York, but ladies and gentlemen, I'm in Georgia. So you gotta understand, that while we're pushing for equity and inclusion, if you push too quickly, you'll experience nullification by the Georgia General Assembly. So you've got to work in partnerships with leading organizations like HUD, Harriet, Secretary Castro, Ed Jennings, and Region 4 to constantly be pushing the envelope. What do I mean? So of course we have inclusionary housing standards. But in all of the construction work that's being done on the Atlanta Beltline, it all has a minority and women participation requirement that currently operates at 27%. And so I think in this planning process, what I would ask that you all start doing is requiring leaders like me and others, it's really, you've got to push on all fronts. And I think you heard that when you were listening to Mayor James. In November, we will have a vote to expand MARTA, which is the ninth largest public transit system in America, yet it receives almost zero state support. We will expand it by $2.6 billion, which matched will probably come out to $4.4 billion. It's the largest expansion of our transit system since our transit system was founded. It will be within 94% of every single person in the city of Atlanta, the additions that we're doing when we're done. All of that's an equity conversation, but it's only an equity conversation if planners are forcing us to think about it. And so you all have a special next step to make. And that special next step is to go beyond your traditional training to be an advocate that the best cities in the world are going to be cities for everybody. And that you are better off when you can show what you have done to have a more inclusive and equitable environment. And I am not just talking about race. Because if there's anything that our political environment is showing, it's that everybody's suffering from a little bit of fear. And what I would say to electeds and people in my position is, when you have a controversy or tough situation regarding planning in the future, you darn well better be able to prove that you've been thinking about it all along. You don't want to be making it up at the time. I don't know whether you all saw the city of Atlanta in June or July, but after two events took place in other cities, so there was a challenge in Minneapolis involving police enforcement, and in Baton Rouge, followed by the awful horror of Dallas, Texas. I was with the mayor of Dallas just the other day. I had 12 to 15,000 people protesting in Atlanta about something that had nothing to do with me. I'm just talking about as a leader of a city. I don't mean in terms of my feeling about America and right and wrong. I'm talking about 12,000 people in my downtown protesting events that occurred in Minneapolis and Baton Rouge. When I had a police department that, what, mirrors the racial composition of the city that it serves, I had 1.6 million officer interactions, less than 10 times our police officers have fired. What has this got to do with planning? It mattered that we could show that on issue after issue, we had thought about having a more inclusive environment. It mattered that we talked about expanding public transportation. It mattered that we had inclusion as a part of the Atlanta Beltline. It mattered that we were passing legislation that said that anytime you use public funding to expand housing options, that you made sure that a mom or dad, a teacher, a firefighter could live someplace. The largest project in downtown Atlanta is being done by a company called Post Properties. It's one of our premier businesses in the city. When Post came to me with that project, it's a $100 million project, I turned it down four times around issues of inclusion. Before we provided $8 million for that Post Properties, we had a number of modifications. But check this out, folks. There are 441 units of housing in that Post Property project. It's across the street from Centennial Olympic Park. It's across the street from the Georgia Aquarium. It's about two blocks away from the headquarters of Coca-Cola. And it's not astronomical, but out of those 441 units of housing, between 45 to 55 units of those housing are going to be lived in for people who are going to pay $1,000 a month. They're going to be in the building with an average rent of between $3,000 to $4,000 a month. Let's never forget what that's going to mean to those 50 families. Now, I've got a county partner, right? I've got a county partner that financed 10,000 units of housing using taxpayer funds. So this isn't any of that pull yourself up by your bootstrap crap. These are business people that use taxpayer subsidies. Without people like you and people like me, you know how many units of affordable housing they have out of that 10,000? 400. Ladies and gentlemen, as much as we enjoy visits like this and important conversations like this, that's a disaster. It's in any strong private sector. In 10,000 units of affordable housing, that's 1,400 families that could have had a life that was better than they had ever had before in an entity that is using taxpayer money to achieve an objective. So all of that has been added into the Atlanta Beltline. And I know that I'm probably singing to the choir, but occasionally the choir needs to be warmed up and needs to be encouraged. So I just want you to know what y'all are doing is important. And as I close, I want to say this. The great thing about where we are right now, the wonderful thing about where we are right now with all of this tension and fear, is that so many of these challenges now apply to a broad enough cross-section where you get to pull the issue of race out of the challenge. And it actually makes it more, makes you more able to achieve path-breaking change. Because I'm telling you, we're right. You know, I travel all over the country. Mayor James and I were laughing about it. Cities are wonderful if you got a lot of money. I mean, just think about it. Could D.C. be any more wonderful for us right now, being at the lowest and where we are and where we can walk to? Or if you're visiting in Atlanta and you're at a conference, it's terrific. But you all, we can't stand aside and watch what's happened to New York and Chicago and San Francisco and not know that whatever size city we are, it's getting ready to be a hip, cool city. Trust me. So let's go ahead and plan and change the conversation and make a clear point as planners that a hip, cool, vibrant, prosperous city has to be a city that when you walk around, you see some of everybody. Thank you.
You can see why these are the mayors we're working with, right? that was great. Well, we have an audience, as you know, that includes a lot of people who are planners or who find planning utterly fascinating. And I'm going to start maybe, Mayor Reed, with your last point, which is planning for success, right? Mayor James talked about neighborhoods that are really struggling. And the kinds of incentives that might be necessary to attract development to those neighborhoods. Every city has been there, right? Not knowing exactly when you reach that tipping point where you don't need to provide those incentives anymore. That's one way of thinking about planning for success. But for a heck of a lot of cities, this city included, the District of Columbia, when things turned around, they turned around on a dime. They turned around incredibly quickly. And as much as you thought you were ready to handle the change, it was overwhelming. So what are some of the things that you have done or that if you had it to do over again, you would have done to be more prepared for that success, or that maybe you'd like to do, you know, for those neighborhoods that haven't yet seen that private investment, but have a lot of the qualities, the locational advantages that make them likely to be that cool, hip place sometime in the near future. What are the things that would need to happen in those neighborhoods so that longtime residents could stay?
Integration of all of the toolkit that the Economic Development Department has into the thinking of our planners and Bureau of Planning. They've been separated for too long. So right now, when we have an economic development conversation, there's a developer that shows up and goes to Invest Atlanta and works on their deal almost completely separate from our planning department, and they don't have the adequate balance. So by the time the deal has been worked on at Invest Atlanta, it puts your planning department in a weakened and a defensive position. And so what needs to happen is we have started two-tracking it faster. So from the moment that large developer or developer of any kind comes on the scene, you need to have two conversations so that as the leader, I can be being influenced by my planner and my economic development people. What I've seen, certainly in my own experience, is that the financial equation overwhelms the planning equation. And so what I've tried to do and what I'm trying to do in Atlanta is make planners like chefs. Have you noticed how cool chefs are now? Like, I never used to, I mean, we have a lot of wonderful restaurants in Atlanta. Chefs are so cool right now in Atlanta. And so I'm on a mission. I've got a planner named Tim Keene who looks like Robert Redford. So this guy, he speaks in more places than I do. Mayor James and I, one of the best mayors in America was a guy named Mayor Riley. Absolutely. From Charleston, South Carolina, who was obsessed with planning. At the end of after serving 40 years, he called me one day and he said, I've got a guy on my team who's my planner. His name is Tim Keene. And his goal in life one day is to be a planner for a major city. He's been with me the whole time. I hired him almost over the phone. Because if you will let your planners go out and be known in the city and in the community, it gives them a greater ability to have their opinion balance out deals. And so one of the things that you and I were talking about at the table was we have this thing called the Atlanta Beltline, which is more popular than everybody in Atlanta, this walk path thing, right? Bikes, I mean, you go out there, it's unbelievable. What it allows is we now have in Atlanta, you can't build on the Beltline without going through a special process because we made the decision that as it relates to the Beltline, we're not going to have junk on the Beltline. It is going to be an asset that is beautiful and it looks beautiful. And just to give you some sense of the magnitude of the Beltline, if you were to take New York's High Line and run it from where it is through the Bronx to Westchester County, that's how big the Beltline is. And so our mission really is to try to make sure that it's beautiful. And that's not a power that the mayor has had in the past. That's one of the mayors all have mayor envy. So, you know, Mayor James has the Kansas City Royals and the big, you know, he won the championship and had this.
Should have won my ring.
And so we all have these things. But, you know, Mayor Daley, I was having dinner with Mayor Daley in Chicago one night. It's a fascinating event. Everybody should do it. And I was a young mayor. I had just been elected mayor. Mayor Daley invited me to dinner. And he sits in the middle of the table and he talks like so low. And you need to. And you have to lean across the table to hear him. But the one thing I wanted to know from Mayor Daley was, how in the world did you shape Chicago skyline the way you did? If I didn't like it, I didn't let him build it. He said, I know what I like.
He said, I traveled around the world. If I'm in France, I saw the candidates, and I came home and I ordered them. He said, I know what I like. That's why you all are so important. There are not a lot of mayors without ability, because he didn't have term limits.
Right? And a strong mayor system.
Yeah, I'm in a strong mayor system, so I can stop a lot of stuff. But this thing around this planner's ability to kind of help us on this beauty thing.
So I know some of you want to get in line to have Mayor Reed call your boss and have a little heart-to-heart. So we'll start making a list and send it around, and that'll be great. Well, I know that you have some things to add to this. I mean,
sure.
So this notion of changing neighborhoods, how do you get ahead of the change, even in those places where you're not sure, you know, when that tipping point is going to happen? Is it going to happen next year? Or is it going to be 2 decades from now?
Well, we've done a number of things that have gone back a number of years, and I agree with a lot of what Mayor Reed said about you better be able to show you've been thinking about this a long time. So one of the first things that we did in my administration was we revamped our economic development corporation and the way that they use incentives and how they're evaluated. And we did it with a wide open 3-year process where citizens from all walks were involved and engaged in focus groups and meetings, etc. And we had an appointed commission that went through this. And we used a consultant judiciously. And probably the best thing that we did was the president of the EDC decided to take another job, and I was able to convince the head of the city planning department to become the head of the Economic Development Corporation. And so there was automatically that knowledge brought to that table. And we created what we call Advanced KC, which uses a scorecard that awards certain points for certain things, and any things that are in distressed or underdeveloped areas get more points, yada, yada, yada. Now, all that is the underlying fabric of the economic development approach. However, we still have to deal with the issue of a surprisingly low level of capacity of CDCs on the east side of town. And one of the things we've done working with LISC and some other members of our CDFI community is to create a pool of patient capital of about $4 million at this point. We're continuing to grow that patient capital pool. And from that patient capital pool, we use that money to award pre-development grants to developers. We've given $850,000 out in the last 6 months, as long as it's been active. And that $850,000 of pre-development grant supports $40 million of development on the east side. So as we continue to do that, we accomplish a couple of things. Number one, we incentivize development. Number two, we strengthen the CDCs and grow that capacity on the east side. And number three, we now have specific projects that we can hold up. Now, we are not just willy-nilly doing this, because what we did was we used about 10 months of time and some consultants to go through the east side and look at what we had already done. We had already made investments of about $3.6 billion in various infrastructure issues and hard assets on the east sides over a period of time in the last 6 years. And what we were looking for was to make sure that we were creating catalytic urban redevelopment. And so the name KC Cure, Kansas City Catalytic Urban Redevelopment, was born. And they selected various nodes of areas where economic activity could be enhanced and used to catalyze other activity around it. And that's where this development is. So as we grow those 6 nodes with development and they expand, then we can start to look at those edges and continue to grow it out and hopefully stop other areas from reaching the tipping point.
So, as you know, housing markets, job markets, transportation systems are all regional. right?
Yeah.
I'm sure that, you know, if you could turn a switch, it would be great for both regions if you were in charge of the whole thing. But
it doesn't have to be on just transportation. We'd like to be in charge anyhow, wouldn't we? Just on anything general.
I'm getting that. I'm getting that vibe.
All right.
But in fact, I think you both have actually done some really good work and some really hard work forming partnerships in your region. Sometimes the partners have been unusual. So Kansas City has been is really the first regional assessment of fair housing, as Mayor James talked about. This is a new regulation at HUD designed to implement the Fair Housing Act, something that we've had in place since the 1960s. But it's a very different, more systematic evaluation of what are the barriers to people of any income, of any race or ethnicity living anywhere in the region that they might want to live in. What prevents that from happening? That's the basic question that's asked by this analysis. And if you're not asking it on a regional basis, then you're not really getting a very helpful answer.
Right?
So you mentioned some of the capacity that was created with the Sustainable Communities Initiative. I'd like to hear you talk a little bit about that.
Sure.
And then I'm going to ask you about MARTA.
Sure. Well, first of all, we have a regional organization called MARC, Mid-America Regional
Council.
I knew it started with a C. But MARC's purpose is to help us address regional issues in Johnson County, Kansas, a very affluent county, Wyandotte County, Kansas, a not so affluent county in the city part, more affluent on the western edge where the racetrack is and the shopping is, etc. Jackson County, Missouri, which is where part of Kansas City resides. Kansas City actually resides in four separate counties, which will forever inhibit the unification of county and city governments. No king gives up their kingdom without a fight. And Kansas City, those are the four major areas. And then the suburbs, we have Blue Springs in Kansas City, in Jackson County, which is a suburb to the east. It's rather affluent, fairly conservative, predominantly white, great schools. We have Leavenworth City, which is an army base, really, the city that surrounds the army base, and one of our major regional partners. And Independence, Missouri, which is immediately to the east of Kansas City, and some other things in Wyandotte County. The barriers are just those things that we already know. Not in my neighborhood. People move to areas in order to accomplish a lot of different things, one of which is to live around people that they want to live around. And they get very resistive to the idea of changing that demographic. We have, however, seen some great leadership from these cities in wanting to make that happen. It is important for us to proceed in a way that does not show fear of the concept of not my neighborhood, but finds ways to address it in a constructive way. So one of the things that we've done is we've talked about, we're working on plans to build housing in such a way that there's not concentrations of people, but that people are integrated into the very fabric of the neighborhoods and into the environment, because really that's what should happen. It's when groups hang together. A quick story. The Plaza in Kansas City is very famous. It's a beautiful, beautiful place. It's a great shopping center. In 2012, we had a problem with young African-American kids in the summertime hanging out on the plaza. And there were big crowds of young African-American kids, hundreds, scared the holy heck out of a bunch of suburban white folks. I'm not lying. I'm just telling it like it is. And with some justification, because some of the things they were doing were not wholesome. That changed when I went down to see for myself what was going on. I had my security detail with me, two officers who never let me drive. And we're walking to a park because we had heard that there was something going on at this park. And as we turned the corner by the Cheesecake Factory and looked back to our left, there was a wall, and I mean a wall of kids. I said it then and I'll say it today, it reminded me of those old Westerns when you look and you see a herd of cattle coming at you. And that's exactly what it looked like. There was a discernible beginning, and then it was just deep. And then three shots rang out, and the herd scattered, and there were kids running everywhere. And it's those types of incidents that further the fear. Because the people who were on the plaza that were not those kids take those incidents back to their homes and say, this is why we live where we live, so we don't have to put up with this. So when we are talking about fair housing, which everyone reads as putting black people in white places, putting Latino people in white places, etc. And the reality is putting people who are of lesser means, black, white, Latino, whatever, in places where they can thrive and succeed. We have to overcome that. Secondly, we have to get to a point where as housing is developed in those areas of our partnership, that we do exactly what Mayor Reed says, that whatever the nature of the housing, the type of the housing, there must be affordable housing included in it, not as a whole, but as a part, so that we can achieve that measured integration of people in a way that is less threatening and therefore has a better chance to be sustainable.
So I was going to ask you about Marta, but before I go there, let me follow up on what Mayor James has said. So when people don't want people who are not like them in a neighborhood, how many times do they say that they don't want the development because it's not consistent with the character of the community? Yeah. Who's heard that before? Anybody?
Oh, yeah.
All right, no one's ever heard of that. So one of the things that you touched on is a role, an unusual role, right? I want to see if anyone else in the room is doing something like this. A nonprofit organization, you know, that has architects and designers in it, is providing a design review for new developments. So that issue of this new housing, some of which is affordable in neighborhoods, right, 45 different communities, that design review is intended to take that argument away, that the compatibility and the appropriateness of this development is going to be managed by this nonprofit, not by the city. So that's unusual. And a little bird tells me in Atlanta that the developers also love it because they don't have to iterate with the planning department and the building permits department, because they come in with a design that is easy to approve, right? And it saves them time and money, and it's often sometimes a more profitable design, maybe less parking than they might have otherwise provided, because the planners know the neighborhoods and know what the household rate of car ownership is and know the proximity to transit. So this, I've never heard of this. Anyone else heard of this? All right, so tell us more about it. It sounds pretty amazing. How's it working?
It's working really nicely, and it was built on the strength of the brand of the Atlanta Beltline. The public has high confidence in the Beltline. It has done what we said it would do. It's brought about the kind of development that we said it would, and so it has a very special place and has a special kind of credibility. And then people have had the discipline not to ruin it. So that's really been the requirement.
What do you mean by that? The discipline not to ruin it?
I could mess it up by using the political capital of the city to start interfering in its decision making. Okay. So everybody, there are a variety of appointments to the Beltline board that has oversight for the commission. And so both the city council, the Beltline Partnership, which is the philanthropic NGO, everybody has shown restraint. So you could have the funders that have raised $54 million for the project try to metal in it. You can have the mayor that believes that I should have input in everything, which I do. But
you actually have the input, or you believe?
No,
you
no. I didn't say I did, but I believe that. And then you have the council, and thus far everybody's shown a lot of discipline. And so the decisions that have been made there have held in a really nice fashion. And then you've got great polling data. I mean, you know, folks like me love to get elected and love to maintain public support. And the Beltline is one of the most important public assets. So people treat it in a very ginger fashion. And so we have a T-SPLOS referendum vote coming up in November that will fund the full right-of-way acquisition of the Atlanta Beltline. And so the aspect that you just discussed is going to get stronger, not weaker.
Right. So I'm going to digress for a second. So we talked about the toolkit, right, that we want best practices to be shared. So let me tell you, that is going to be a best practice that we're going to share. And I want all of you to think about a trusted nonprofit in your community who might be able to take those responsibilities on. In Atlanta, it's mandatory. You can imagine it might start out as advisory, right? But that is that issue gets raised every time. That's the first issue people raise, because nobody says what Mayor James has said is that I don't want people who aren't like me living in my neighborhood. So they say community character, design. It may not fit in that extra story or that multifamily building. It just won't fit into our neighborhood. And this is a way that that I think everybody might be able to use to overcome those kinds of objections. So you have a transit agency. How many of you have a transit system in your community, rail or any fixed guideway system? Okay, so MARTA, I understand that your partner in MARTA, they own land around their transit stations, right? Everybody does it. They own the stations themselves and sometimes other right-of-way. I understand that MARTA actually lowers the cost basis in the land in order to get affordable units on transit when they do a development deal. Is that true?
That's true. So MARTA has what we call transit-oriented developments, and because of the surge of cities and the success of cities, people would now want to live around our transit systems, which for a southern city like Atlanta, not a northeastern city, that's pretty remarkable. And so we have four different transit-oriented developments that are going out right now. All of them have been responded to in a remarkable fashion. And you know, the fact of the matter is, what's really driving the development is that Atlanta is winning the jobs war in Georgia. So if you were to do a quick Google search of us, on Monday, Honeywell announced 850 new jobs in Atlanta, 800 IT jobs. GE Digital announced 250 jobs for GE Digital. Kaiser Permanente announced 900 jobs. But if I were putting these on a dot, every single one of them is near a MARTA transit stop. So NCR is building a 5,000 employee campus. State Farm is building an 8,000 employee campus right outside of the city. Pulte Homes, their headquarters, right on the Beltline corridor. The point I'm making is that everybody, the jobs are going near transit. So that's helping us end the old transit arguments. Whose neighborhood is it? Are black people coming into the neighborhood? Millennials are overwhelming that conversation. So millennials are, we might care about cars, millennials don't. There was a German survey that's 2 years old now that asked driving age German youth whether they'd rather have a car or their mobile won 70%. And so my sense is that MARTA is really driving all of that. And that the referendum that we have coming up in November is going to pass overwhelmingly. In the past, we had had people in who were still in a funeral home vote to pass a vote for MARTA. So we don't have to turn to the cemeteries to pass this MARTA vote. I'm just joking.
You did talk to Mayor Daley.
Yeah. See how bright you are. And so I just think it's just an amazing time. I think success, you mentioned the region. Success helps you lead the region.
Yeah.
People like winners. And the fact of the matter is, our metro's GDP is now $305 billion. We're the ninth biggest metro in America. The city of Atlanta has had population growth since 2010. It's unprecedented in the history of the city. Last year, we had $2.9 billion in new construction permits, the highest level in the history of the city, including the Centennial Olympic Games. We're approaching the largest cash surplus, no property tax increases, no water rate increases, and I think that helps lead a region more than I need you to be for me, because people see where the businesses are choosing to locate and where the talent is choosing to locate, and it makes how we can partner and get along a more comfortable collegial conversation. You just have to not be a jerk when you're being successful.
Yeah, right.
I mean, you all know, certainly our planners and folks in cities, when we get hot, we have to be disciplined when folks
call up
to talk about it, to say, hey, come on in, I'll show you everything I got. Candace has been to Mayor James' city and spent time with Mayor James. The great thing about being a mayor, and I believe it would also apply to being a planner, is you only have to give the other person credit once. One of these, and once you say, you know, Mayor James suggested, you get to do that one time, then the other 99 times, you get to say a colleague recommended, then you get to say a friend told me, and then, you know, it's just, when I had this idea about it.
Well, I think that that these are all very helpful lessons you two mayors are imparting to us. But I do think you're making the point, like all of us worked in cities where we might have been the butt of jokes. You know, that regional conversation was impossible to have because people didn't respect what we were trying to do in cities. And now it is totally different, and it is hard not to gloat. But I appreciate the discipline you're both exercising. But let's just also acknowledge that one of the other things that is helping this conversation along is that poverty is suburbanizing.
Well, yeah. Sure. Yeah.
Right? And that's helping you in your conversations in places where, you know, the racial composition is different, but now the economics are really changing.
That's absolutely true. I am a little older than Mayor Reed, although you really can't tell it. But I remember growing up in the 60s when certain drugs became a major problem. And as long as the conversation was localized about drugs being in the core of the city, the way that the subject was addressed and discussed was one way. When they started showing up in the suburbs, then all sorts of things changed. That's the same thing that's going on now with issues related to income inequality and poverty and public safety. The whole idea of migration of people from one area to another, the reverse migration from suburbs to the cities, is because of things that are only available as a result of certain levels of density. The concentration of jobs in Atlanta will pull people from suburbs into the city because that's where the jobs are, and it's better to be closer to the jobs than it is to have to drive, spend an hour in a car. It's better to not have to spend any time in a car if you've got the right modes of transportation. But the one thing that I'll say about this, and I don't feel any great need to gloat, because every time I talk about or feel the need to talk about the truly tremendous things going on in Kansas City, I must acknowledge that the only way that those things happen is by a tremendous focus, collaborative effort of a lot of people bringing a lot of skills to the table simultaneously and staying on task and being there not when the project is half done, but at the concept stage, so that as we put together the concept, everybody has input into it and therefore ownership of it, and therefore acts as a marketing agent for it, a person who will be there to sustain it, and that's true in your city, it's true in mine, and I think that's true of your leadership style as well as mine. We know that if you want big things done, you've got to bring big people to the table and work with them in order to get that done. I think that the thing that's really been truly remarkable is the expansion of the people at the table. It used to be that the people at the table were the well-heeled, the business people, yada, yada, yada. Quick story, I remember the day after I was elected in 2011, I'm at the Unity breakfast eating the cold eggs and daydreaming about time off and how I'm gonna transition my law firm, which never actually did happen. And the chairman of the chamber came up, whispered in my ear, wanted me to come to a meeting afterwards. Okay, cool, so I go to a meeting. And he wants me to step into the negotiations with Google. But he also wants me to go to a meeting of, quote, the city or the city's business leaders to talk to a CEO about not moving their company out of the city. So I go to this meeting, and literally, if it wasn't for me being elected, and if it wasn't for the transition of Clyde McQueen, a guy that does FEC work in Kansas City who's known all over the country, being the chair of EDC, it would have been a room of middle-aged white guys wearing striped ties in a bank. And the only women I saw were bringing things in or taking things out. The interesting thing was the CEO, who was a friend of mine, somebody I'd known, was a Latino. And so when he came in and kind of looked around, he came and sat next to me. So two-thirds of the diversity were sitting in one spot. I started at that point in time starting to tell people when they would invite me to these meetings or the magazines. You probably have a magazine that does the 40 top people in this and the rising stars of that and the best group of young whatever. And they want me to come, not because they wanted me, but because they thought that by having the mayor, it would enhance their stuff. I said, I'm not coming anymore until you diversify in all areas, in terms of income, in terms of race, in terms of sex, in terms of gender, rather, in terms of sexual orientation, in terms of all sorts of different things. And I stopped going to some of those things. We've also incorporated that in what we do. When we put together groups anymore, we're looking for diversity across the board and across counter sections so that everybody has a voice, we have some representation. That's the only way that we can make good decisions for a city that is diverse, and that's the only way that we can get things through to voters who are diverse, is to make sure that they're represented in the concept stage. That's how cities are being built, and that's why it's great to be a mayor, because we get to do neat stuff like that.
And if you want a cool way to say that, you just say, I want to plan with, not plan on.
Brilliant.
So I think that we're nearing the end of our time, and which I totally regret, because you've given us such insight into the mind of a mayor. I know we're going to be able to use this, you know, in our daily lives, but also inspired us, you know, with how you do your jobs, and it's been great to hear how important you think planning is, and I do believe it's not just because you're, you know, in an audience of planners, but because it really does inform the future of your city, how it's going to work, how people are going to be able to live in that city. And I think you've also created in all of us a sense of urgency, you know, that this stuff is happening fast and it happens before you know it, and that it's not enough to be, to create a statistically mixed income or mixed race neighborhood. You have to create places like the Beltline where people who are not like each other can safely and easily meet each other, mingle with each other. So that civic commons, that place where that was the basis for cities, right? That we have that in our communities going forward. Places where people not like us, right, but like our city, right, can come together. That's so important. So please join me in thanking these amazing men.
Yeah. I'm warmed up and encouraged. How about you? Yeah. Harriet, Mayor James, and Mayor Reed, thank you so much for being with us tonight and sharing your insights and for your tremendous national leadership on issues that make our cities and communities more just and more prosperous. We look forward to continuing this conversation and to work together and our work together. I can also announce that APA will be launching work on a new policy guide on equity and inclusive growth. I hope everyone will work with us on this important endeavor. And I also want to let our mayors know we have mayors who are members of APA. And thank you for joining us this evening. I hope you'll be with us tomorrow for other sessions that will continue tonight's conversation. And now, please join us in the Constitution Room for a special reception.